Welcome back, everybody, to Algebra 1AB. Today we've got 9.5B, Day 2. So again, this is quadratics in real life. We talked about objects in motion yesterday, and so this will wrap up our Chapter 9. Again, it's not really 9.5 per se because it doesn't align with the textbook in that way because we're not really using quadratic formula a whole lot here, but it's just kind of showing us other ways that quadratics show up in real life. So we wanted to kind of group that in with the sections of the book that are covering that. All right, so this is actually a really nice lesson to be doing towards the end of the year as almost all of you will be going on to a geometry class next year. And so we start off with some geometric figures, and we're going to go from a geometry formula to an expression, and possibly, if we're asked to solve, a solution. So our first example, it doesn't say to solve anything, just write a polynomial. So here I'm looking at a figure that is a rectangle, and we're told to use the area of that shaded figure. So here the area of a rectangle is its length times its width. And here one of these little expressions, like this 2x minus 9 and this x plus 5, those binomials are representing the length and the width of that rectangle. So I'm going to go ahead and substitute those in to get a polynomial. Instead of the length, I'm going to substitute in the 2x minus 9 binomial. And instead of the width, I'm going to substitute in the x plus 5 binomial. Well, what I've just written here doesn't really look like a polynomial yet, does it? But we've got some factors that have x's in them. And so if I FOIL those together, like we did, you know, back in Chapter 7, that will give me a quadratic expression. It'll give me a trinomial. So let's see. My first times first is 2x times another x. My outside is 2x times 5. My inside is negative 9 times x. And my last times last is negative 45. And I can clean up that polynomial just like with almost all FOILing problems by combining the like terms in the middle. 2x squared plus 1x, or just plus x, minus 45. There is my polynomial. Let's try number two. Here we've got a triangle, and a triangle is really like a rectangle that's been folded corner to corner. So we're really only seeing half of a rectangle. So the area of a triangle is going to be 1/2 times the base of that triangle times its perpendicular height. Perpendicular meaning, of course, 90 degrees. Remember that from way back in Chapter 4. So in this case, I've got A equals 1/2 times the base, which is the expression p plus 1, times the height, which is the expression 2p minus 6. All right, now my advice to you is to leave the 1/2. It's tempting to want to distribute in, but we can group the multiplication in such a way that we're doing our FOILing first, and I strongly encourage you to do that. So let's see, first times first, I've got 2p times another p. Outside, I've got p times negative 6. Inside, 1 times 2p, and last times last is a minus 6. We'll combine our like terms in the middle, and you kind of see I'm just kind of hanging on to that 1/2 until I've done all the FOILing work, and then I'll distribute it in. So 1/2 times 2p, well, what's half of 2p to the second? That's just 1p to the second. What's half of negative 4p? That's negative 2p. And what's half of negative 6? Well, that's negative 3. There's our expression. All right, now you'll notice I use B and H for base and height instead of length times width. I only chose that switch because I know that's how our geometry teachers present that formula. Realize it still is doing the same thing as length and width. We're still just multiplying those two expressions together like we did in the first example. Whoops. That's what I wanted to go to. Let's move down to example 3. All right, now we're trying to write a polynomial that represents the area of just the shaded region. So we've got this big rectangle, but not the whole rectangle is shaded. And so if you take a look at it, there's actually four like perfect matched triangles here, right? And only two of those are shaded. So really two of the four triangles is 1/2 of the shape. Right, so the area here, it's not going to be length times width, but half of the length times width that I'm given for this rectangle. So it's going to kind of be similar to the last one where we've got this 1/2 out front. My length, I'll use the expression x plus 6 along the bottom, and then along the side here, running up and down the x plus 5. That's my other expression. Let's do our foiling first. We'll leave the 1 half out front. First times first is x times x. Outside, I've got plus 5x. Inside, I've got 6 times x. And last times last is plus 30. Now let's go ahead and distribute our one. Oh, hold on. Don't distribute yet. We have to combine like terms first. So that area is going to be 1 half of x squared plus 5 and 6, 11x total plus 30. And now we'll distribute the 1 half. So I've got 1 half x squared plus 11 halves x plus 15. All right, so that's the first concept, just to get us used to turning expressions in a geometry diagram into the polynomials, the algebraic stuff we've been working with all year. Example 4, it actually says find the dimensions. Now, when they use the word dimensions, they mean what is the length. So if this is like a board that we're using to cover a floor or something like that, what is this actual number of feet for length? What is this actual number of feet for width? Because we don't want x's. We just want to know what those numbers are at the end. Okay, and so if I were to describe like the classroom that I'm teaching in, I would say it's 22 feet wide by 24 feet long. And so that's what dimensions look like. Again, very common in like blueprints and technical, kind of like engineering architecture type things. But a lot of times you're faced with this as like a future homeowner, perhaps in the real world. So it's really neat geometry that you'll find yourself later on in life appreciating. Oh, I remember that. You know, that's kind of coming in handy in weird places. All right, so let's not get ahead of ourselves. What do we know? We've already kind of specified that we've got the length and the width as expressions. And here we're also actually told what the area of this rectangle should be. So let's see. Let's start with the area of a rectangle, length times width. I know the area is 44. I can substitute in that. I know my length is the binomial x minus 5, and the width is the binomial x minus 12. So you can kind of see how now I've actually got, because I have area that's known, I've got an equation that I can actually solve. So let's go ahead and do our foiling work. First times first, outside, inside. Last times last is negative 5 times negative 12. That's a plus 60. And I'm going to go ahead and combine like terms. And now you'll notice if I'm solving a quadratic like this, we now know several different ways to do that. We could complete the square. We could use quadratic formula. We could graph this. But we're going to have very little luck unless that polynomial is set equal to 0. So I'm actually going to subtract 44 from both sides. And then just a little heads up, these geometry type problems, you won't have to do quadratic formula. Obviously, if you're really confident with that, by all means, go ahead. But you're going to be much better off using magic numbers factoring from chapter 7. So in this case, the lead is 1. So magic numbers and done for me. So I want the two magic numbers that will multiply to be 16 and add up to negative 17. Those magic numbers are negative 1 and negative 16. X minus 1, X minus 16. If I solve the mini equations for this, X minus 1, my first factor could equal 0, or X minus 16, my second factor could equal 0. And let's just solve those. I'll add 1 to both sides and I get X equals 1. I'll add 16 to both sides and I get X equals 16. And it feels like we're done. But they didn't ask us what is x. They said find the dimensions. So let's try plugging in this x equals 1. If I had 1 minus 5, that's a negative 4. And am I able to go to like a Menards and say, hey, I need a sheet of plywood that's negative 4 feet long? No. So this one will not make sense because it gives me negative values. Let's try the 16. If I did 16 minus 5, that gives me a positive 11. Okay, let's try the width. If I did 16 minus 12, I'm just replacing the x with the solution that we had, then I would get 4. Okay, so those both came out as positive values. So I can use the 11 and the 4. Now that I've plugged x back in, I can actually answer how many feet are long, how many feet wide this would need to be. And it's something we could measure in real life. Very, very cool. All right, example number 5. Same concept here, but now we're working with a right triangle. Area of a triangle, like our second example today, is 1/2 times the base times the height of that triangle. Okay, and here we've got a perpendicular base and a height. My base is g minus 8, my height is g minus 11, and my area is 35. So again, I'm just going to substitute in. This time I know I can substitute in the area as well, which is really, really nice. It gives me something to solve. Now, I'm going to show you a little pro tip. Because a lot of our geometry formulas will have fractions involved, it's a very good idea, since we're solving an equation, to get rid of the fraction first. And so here, if I went in and FOIL'd, that wouldn't get rid of this fraction, would it? However, if I multiply both sides of the equation by the reciprocal of that fraction, in this case, multiply both sides by 2, multiplying by the reciprocal will cancel out that fraction from all this multiplication. So I've actually got 2 times 35, which is 70, equaling g minus 8 times g minus 11. Now let's FOIL. I already feel much better about this without that fraction in the way. Let's combine our like terms. We've now got an equation that we can solve. All right, we're not going to have much luck solving if we do not have that polynomial set equal to 0, so let's subtract 70 from both sides. And I have 0 equals g squared minus 19g plus 18. Okay, just like before, this is going to be another magic numbers factoring. But here, we've got a lead of 1, so again, it's magic numbers and done. What two magic numbers will multiply to be 18 and add up to negative 19? Those magic numbers are a negative 1 and a negative 18. So I know my factors are g and negative 1, g minus 1, g and negative 18, g minus 18. Let's solve the many equations and see which one works for our dimensions. Because again, we want some number of meters for this height and some number of meters for this base. Well, just like the last time, if we just go ahead and solve, let's find the unknown. We get g equals 1 as a possibility. And my other mini equation tells me g could equal 18. If I try to substitute in a 1 into the base here, I would have 1 minus 8, which is negative 7. And just like before, these are real world measurements. I can't grab a tape measure and measure out negative 7 meters. That just doesn't work. So this answer is not acceptable. Let's do 18 minus 8. That gives me 10. And then for my height, 18 minus 11 gives me 7. So I know that that 7 and that 10 represent, represent the dimensions of that triangle. Those are the base and height measurements we were looking for. All right, and then lastly, example 6. This is a good indication of a type of SAT problem that has you put together some geometry and some algebra. So it's not intended to be an SAT problem, but it is designed to show you ideas coming together. A farmer plants a rectangular pumpkin patch. So in the diagram, that's this little corner here that's a rectangle in the northeast corner of a square plot of land. Okay, so they tell us S meters by S meters, so we know that these are equal in length, so we've got a perfect square. The area of the pumpkin patch is 600 square meters. What's the area of the square plot of land? So here, this rectangle has a certain length and a certain width, okay? And if this whole thing makes an edge of the square, that means this 40 plus L is equal to S, right? One of the side lengths. And then over here, this one, this 30 plus W, that if I add those two lengths together, also equals S. Okay, so let's take a look. What do we know? I know that the area of the pumpkin patch is equal to just L times W, right? To find the area of just this rectangle, I would just be taking L times W. I know that that area is 600. All right. Now, I'm trying to find the area of the square, so I'll call that AS. And that's going to equal 40 plus L times 30 plus W. And this actually combines in a very, very, very neat way. So let's see, AS is what I'm solving for. And so if I were to FOIL this out, 40 times 30 is 1,200. Then my outside is plus 40W. My inside is plus 30L. And my last times last is plus LW. All right. So now, how can we solve this? We have an awful lot of variables here. How can I actually get a number for this AS? Well, let's see, we've got 1200 plus 40W plus 30L plus L times W. We know that already, that's 600. So AS is equal to 1200 plus 600. Let's combine some like terms here, 1800 plus 40W plus 30L. All right. Now, we're going to have some other crafty substitutions, and this is in no way the only way to do this problem, so I'm just going to go ahead and throw that one out there. But we have too many variables going on here. If I wanted to find the area of the entire square, that would be its length times its width. In other words, the area of the square is s squared. So let's go ahead and substitute in s squared, and I already know that S is equal to 30 plus W, and S is also equal to 40 plus L. Okay, so S to the second power is actually equal to these two multiplied. Ooh, which I think I'm backtracking. Hold on. I kind of like when this happens. I think I'm going in a circle because I've already done the product of those two up here. Okay. Let's see. We have plenty of information to work with. Oh, I've got it. So up here, when we said 40 plus L is equal to S, if I subtract 40 from both sides, that would tell me that L equals S minus 40. And if I do the same thing here, subtract away the 30, W is equal to S minus 30. So now we've got some substitutions that we can make for W and L. So AS is going to be 1800 plus 40 times, let's see, we said W is S minus 30 plus 30L, which we said was S minus 40. So AS equals 1800 plus, let's distribute, 40S minus 1200 plus, got to distribute again, don't we? 30 times S is 30S, and then minus 1200 again. So the area of S is equal to 70S minus 600. Yes, and then as we said before, that's S squared is the area of the big square. So now you can see that trinomial that shows up. Now again, I feel like I'm taking a very roundabout way of doing this. I'm sure there's a more efficient way of lining this up, but I kind of like thinking through these on the fly so you can kind of see the thought process and how what we've learned kind of comes together in different ways. So if I want to solve this for S, which I do, I'm going to go ahead and get this trinomial set equal to 0. And believe it or not, this one is a magic numbers problem. So I want two numbers that will multiply to be 600, but add up to negative 70. Okay, those two magic numbers are 60 and 10. So, negative 60 and negative 10. So I have factors of S minus 60 and S minus 10. So my first mini equation, S minus 60 equals 0. Second mini equation, S minus 10 equals 0. If I add 60 to both sides, S equals 60. And for the second mini equation, if I add 10 to both sides, S equals 10. All right, now let's go back and check with some of our work up here in red and blue. If I plug in S equals 10 up here, 10 minus 40 gives me a length of negative 30. That's not a very happy farmer. He's certainly not selling a whole lot of pumpkins, is he? So this S equals 10 is not acceptable. We want positive measurements only. Let's try the 60. So if I have 60 minus 40, I would get 20 for L. And down here for W, if I did 60 minus 30, I would get 30 for this dimension right here for this W. So L and W are 20 and 30, respectively. So let's go back here to where we found AS. We need to actually calculate now. So the area of the square is equal to 40 plus L, which is 20, times 30 plus 30. And really, since we knew S was 60, we could have done this just by doing 60 times 60. That's what we're doing right here. The area of that square is 3,600 square meters. Again, I know I took a very long route with the substitutions in this one. There are definitely other ways of doing this problem that are probably more efficient in terms of writing. But I hope this made sense as you were going through and kind of gave evidence of how we can find some very, very bizarre unknowns based on very limited information that we're given. Really, really cool. I hope we can appreciate a situation like that. All right, everybody, that does it for 9.5B, the second day, geometry. Thanks for watching.